In this video, we'll be looking at how we use data and how we use computers to help us look at data. So why do we analyze data? Well, we need to look at data to find out trends and find patterns, and that helps us make decisions. So we gain benefits in science and research and in business. So let's have a look at data. Well, for us, we normally have text in reports, in paragraphs, but we also have data in tables that's structured to make it look easier. Another way we can look at data, simple way to look at trends, would be to use charts and diagrams. We can store data in simple text files, which has the extension .txt. If we want to separate the values, such as we do in spreadsheets, we can use a comma-separated values file, a CSV file. Now in spreadsheets, we normally access data that's in numerical form, and we can use functions like counts and sum and average. Another way we can store data is in a database, and these are specially built to use metadata. So it's like having a table with columns and rows, and we can access data by using the metadata, the data about the data. So for example, if we want to find someone's name, we can use the column last name, first name, and then find the person from that column. So we can access data in a database. It's easier to use a special language called Structured Query Language, SQL. An SQL select statement, you would have select, which you choose the columns you want to see from the tables, and where, which select which rows you want to see. We also have a large amount of data on the internet. Now, how this is stored and accessed depends on the structure. We have normal text in paragraphs, which we would call not structured. We've got tables and such, which is structured. And we've got semi-structured data. So for example, an email, you would have like a key, like to and from and date, and then you'd have the data, maybe two people's names and then the date. So that's semi-structured data. So how can we access web data? Well, we personally use web browsers and things like search engines that use key terms to find the data we want. Now, search engines use spiders to find the web pages that are relevant to what we're looking for. We can actually write these in computer programs. Another way we can access web data is using an API, an application program interface. So that way a computer can go to the web page database and collect a lot of data. So this might lead us on to using big data. So what is big data? Well, the term was created in 2001, and it describes the growth and availability of data. Computers now can store so much data and have the power to use it. So being able to analyze data has become easier. So big data has a lot of volume. We can access set data, and also we have a lot of variety of types of data. So where is this data stored? Well, if you think of your hard drive in your computer, it can store quite a lot of data. Now, if you think how many hard drives would you need for all the data on the internet, you can see that we really need huge buildings that have a lot of equipment with a lot of hard drives, with a lot of connections to be able to store and access so much data. We have a lot of data on the internet for like social media, about people, marketing, sales, tweets, and emails. So with big data, it's too big to be stored in a database. So we need to store it in a more simple way. So we can use the key value pair, which is kind of semi-structured, although we can store different structures in big data. So you can see here we have simple keys and simple values, but we can change the value to a different format if we wish. Another way we might access and analyze data is using machine learning. Now, machine learning has many different approaches. What we can think of supervised machine learning, where we give examples and we label that data, and then the supervised learning learns from the input to get to the output. Not supervised finds patterns like clustering, and also we have reinforced learning, which we can see in these examples. The reinforced learning will try something, and if it works, it can reward that. We see clustering, and also a type of supervised machine learning, linear regression. Linear regression, we use examples and we can map them, and then we can get an idea so we can predict values based on other data. Now, machine learning, such as supervised and unsupervised, it depends on the accuracy of the training data. What about neural networks? Well, how does they work? Well, imagine if you want to adjust your TV. What setting do you use for volume? You probably don't use a setting. You just turn it up or down until you find the correct level. And you might do the same with the color and the brightness, the contrast, etc. Well, neural networks work the same. They have weights, and they just adjust the weights up and down until the input maps to the output. So we can see an example of the use of neural networks with image recognition. So we have an image. Now, the different weights inside the nodes in the neural network have these values, and we have weights, and then they adjust them until the output is correct to our examples. And we use so many that these weights adjust, and then when we have an image, we can then see which type of the output we think the image is. So in this example, we have an image of a plane, and on the output on the right hand side, you can see plane has the highest value. Now, there are some ethical issues. Is the data secure? We have personal information, but who can access this personal information? And if we analyze the data, will there be any bias? Now, we've seen in other machine learning approaches in the past, there has been bias against race and gender. So, for example, job candidates, people recommitting crimes, and facial recognition systems have a bias towards one race or gender. So we can see inaccuracies in the analysis of the data. So we have to be careful of the bias. Okay, if you like this video, please give us a like. If you haven't already, subscribe, and look out for our next videos.